हेलो फ्रेंड्स, टुडे इज अवर लेक्चर नंबर 4. ओके, लेक्चर नंबर 4 ऑफ अवर अमेंडमेंट बैच 3, एंड आई एम ऑन पेज 40. सो प्लीज ओपन पेज नंबर 40 ऑफ योर प्रिंटेड कॉपी ऑफ नोट्स. विल कंटिन्यू द डिस्कशन फ्रॉम वेयर वी लेफ्ट. सो आई एम रीडिंग क्वेश्चन 4A. लेट अस चेक, वी आर डिस्कसिंग द प्रैक्टिकल क्वेश्चंस एंड आई होप दीज आर यूजफुल टू यू. If you find that due to my discussion, that is due to these video lectures, you are in a better position to understand the question and solution, then you may continue watching these lectures. If you have already understood on your own by reading the question, then please don't waste time on watching these video lectures. Then you can devote your time to some other subject. But if you find it useful, then please continue. So I'm on question 4A. A chemical company produces two chemicals, SX and ZX. Environmental activities and cost associated with the two chemicals are as follows. So it seems to be the question related to environmental management accounting. Units produced are given in kgs, that is 6 lakh and 15 lakh. Packing material is given in kgs, that is 80,000, 40,000. Energy usage in kWh is 60,000, 30,000. Toxin releases pounds into air, that is amount of toxin, that is toxic chemical or toxic waste or air is released, 2 lakh and 40,000. Then pollution control machine hours is 32,000 and 8,000. Now cost of environmental activities are given to you. Environmental costs are given, that is packing material cost is 3 lakh 60,000, energy cost is 96,000, fines for release of toxins into air is 48,000. And operating cost of pollution control equipments is 1,12,000. And the question is required. Calculate the environmental cost per kilogram for each chemical produced by the company. So we have to calculate environmental cost, that is environmental management accounting, using activity based costing. And we have to express that environmental cost per kg of output. Now I'll just discuss from here itself. You have to just decide which environmental cost which will be shared in which proportion between the two products, SX and ZX. Now check this packing material cost. It's, I think, very simple question for 5 marks. Packing material cost will be shared in this ratio, that is how much packing material you have used, that is in the ratio 8:4, right? That is 8:40 or 8:4 or 2:1, whatever you call. In this ratio, then energy cost 96,000 will be shared by, in this ratio, energy usage, that is 6:3, 60,000, 30,000, again that is 2:1. So 6:3 ratio you can share this. Then fines for release of toxins into air, that is 48,000 rupees. This will be shared in this ratio, toxin released, that is 200:40, or if you delete 440s, it will be 20:4 ratio, 20:4. And operating cost of pollution control equipment, 1,12,000. This cost will be shared in the ratio of pollution control machiners, that is 32:8. Now, once you share these environmental cost in this ratio, you will take the total of the cost, and total cost divided by this quantity, 6 lakh kg units produced and 15 lakh kg of units produced. So total cost divided by quantity, you will get environmental cost per kg. That's all, my dear friends. It is that simple. You will find the printed solution ahead. So we'll go ahead now. Okay, there was one or question to this. This question was on triple bottom line. Okay, theory question. In triple bottom line, you have to discuss about right planet and society and so on. So let us just read the question. The triple bottom line recognizes that a company's performance should not only be viewed in terms of ability to generate economic profits for its owners, but also by the impact on the people and the planet for its long-term economic and social viability. People and planet also, not just profit. XYZ Limited has recently undertaken initiatives towards the sustainability as below. And there are some 5 items are given. It's very, very simple. Identify whether the initiative would primarily impact people, planet, or profit. Triple bottom line, three criteria to measure the performance. So you have to, it's very simple question, you do it on your own and then check with the printed answer. Like you have to just say that this reduced, reduce the amount of plastic usage in the peanut butter jars. Reduce the amount of plastic usage in peanut butter jars. Now due to this, whether you will be impacting people or planet or profit, I'm not saying anything, you do that thing and then check it with the answer. So you have to just write for one whatever you like planet, and two whatever. So people, planet and profit in three you have to divide and go ahead. So very very simple, let's go ahead. But you try on your own. You should hit all five out of five, right? Which measure the company is taking will help in improving the quality of people or planet, or will help you to earn more profit. So that is what you have to just write one of the three names for 5 marks and 5 questions. Very very simple, 5 words you have to write. So these are called bonus questions, my dear friends. So such questions are also there in the exam where you can score the marks without efforts. Okay, this is B question. B question is a case scenario, my dear friends, for small for 5 marks, 2 plus 3. So just go through, it's a small question and answer is printed. It's a case scenario. So you have to write a theory answer. I'm going ahead. Question C, I'll read. It seems to be on transfer pricing. Question C seems to be on transfer pricing, divisional transfer pricing. Right, APC has two divisions, division X and division Y, with full profit responsibility. So they are responsible to generate profit. Division X produces component Jex, which is supplied to both division Y also and external customer. So division X supplies this product or component Jex to division Y and to external customers. Division Y produces a product called Jextin. This is the output of division Y, which incorporates component X. Means Jextin uses a component X, Jex, which is taken from division X. For 1 unit of Jextin, 2 units of component Jex and other material are used. Please remember, to produce each unit of Jextin, you need 2 units of the components of Jex and plus some other material. Till date, division Y has always bought component Jex from division X at rupees 50 per unit. Till now, division is buying it always from division X. At what price? 50 rupees per unit. Since the lowest price at which component Jex could have been bought by division Y was 52 per unit. Now, why it was buying from division X at 50? Because the outside purchase price, lowest price, was 52. So as compared to 52, 50 rupees was the internal transfer price, which was cheaper for division Y. Therefore, they purchased it. Now, division X charges the same price for component Jex to both division Y and external customers. It means division X is selling this component Jex to division Y also and to external customers also. At what price? At 50 rupees per unit. However, it doesn't incur selling and distribution cost when transferring internally. Naturally, for internal transfer, you don't have to incur the selling and distribution cost. So it doesn't incur the selling and distribution cost on internal transfer. Now, division Y has received a proposal from a new supplier who has offered to supply Jex for 47 per unit at least for the next 3 years. So some outside supplier is ready to supply that component at 47 rupees now. That is cheaper than 50 rupees. Now, manager of division Y requests the manager of division X to supply the component Jex at or below rupees 47 per unit. Naturally, when you are getting it from outside at 47, so you should request your internal division also to supply at 47 or less. Now, manager of division X is not ready to reduce the transfer price, since the divisional performance evaluation is done based on profit margin ratios of the division. So division X is not ready to reduce the price because its profit will get affected. The following additional information is made available to you. Check the additional information. Selling price per unit of component JX is 50. This is in division X, my dear friend. This product is produced in division X and JX10 is produced in division Y. Selling price of JX10 is 180. Less variable cost. These are variable costs which we are discussing. So these are all variable costs. Direct material. In direct material, component JX is used in JX10. Now that component was charged at the rate of 50 per unit. Now some of you may get surprised why 100 is written. If you remember, 2 units of JX is required to produce each unit of JX10. So this 100 is nothing but 50 rupees per unit, which is the selling price for division X, but purchase price for division Y. So Y is buying component JX at rupees 50 per unit, but 2 units are required to produce each unit of JX10. Therefore, it is 100 rupees. Then other material is 12, 22, direct labor is 16 and 13, manufacturing overheads are 2 and 5, and selling and distribution cost is 4 and 2. Now please remember, this division X doesn't incur this cost, this 4 rupees, when it does the internal transfer. So on internal transfer, this 4 rupees cost is not incurred, okay? And contribution per unit is given as 16 and 38, it is readily given, ready made. Annual fixed cost is also given to you, 40 lakhs and 20 lakhs. Now, annual external demand in units is given, 3 lakh, 1 lakh 20,000, that is annual external demand. This is external demand, please remember. And the capacity of the plant, the total capacity of the plant is to produce 5 lakh and 1 lakh 50,000 units, whereas the annual external demand is 3 lakh and 1 lakh 20,000 units. And there are few questions in the required. Please read these three questions. I give you some time, 2, 4 and 4 marks, that is 10 marks questions. Read it carefully and then we will discuss together. Please go through the question. Done. Okay, let's see one by one. Calculate the present profit of each division and the company as a whole for 2 marks. Present profit means when division Y purchases its entire requirement from division X at 50 rupees, then what is the profit? Second question is analyze the impact on the total annual profit of each division and the company as a whole if division Y accepts the offer of new supplier. New supplier is going to supply at 47 rupees. So if division Y buys from outside, what will be the impact on profit? That is second question. And then third question, we'll see later. Let us go one by one. See, first of all, from here, as division Y purchases its entire requirement from division X at present, I'm talking about question one, and its external demand is 120,000 units for division X, for division Y, sorry, for JX10. So for to produce 120,000 units into 2, you will need 240,000 units of JX, correct? So division Y will buy 240,000 units from division X at the rate of 50. I'm talking about first question, present profit. Now, division X has a capacity to produce 5 lakh units. Out of 5 lakh, 240,000 will be supplied to division Y first, because division Y purchases entire requirement from X. So from 5 lakh, 240,000 is gone. So what will be left? Take the calculator. 5 lakh minus 240,000 will be 260,000 units are the capacity left with division X. Now you can easily sell 260,000 units in the external market, because external market demand is 3 lakh units. But out of 3 lakh, you will be able to sell only 260,000, because that is the capacity left with you. And if we use the approach of marginal costing for external sale of JX, this is the variable cost entire for external sale. And for internal sale, this much only will be the variable cost, because 4 rupees selling and distribution you won't be incurring on internal sales. and entire total will be for external sales. Is that okay? Should we go to the solution? This is a very simple question. I'll explain directly the solution, because it will be difficult for me to do the calculations here now. I have to bend and there is no space for writing, but solutions are already printed. So let us see it from here. This was your environmental management accounting, simple question. This was your triple bottom line answer. Right, we are, it was theory question, I think, right. This was the theory question of case scenario. Now, we are here, question 4C. Check variable cost per unit of GX for outside cell. So, I have taken all variable cost. All variable cost were given there. 12 plus 16 plus 2 plus 4. So, it is 34 rupees. Actually, in the question, they have given contribution per unit also. Now, variable cost per unit of GX for internal transfer. So, 4 rupees you are saving. So, it will be only 30 rupees here. This will be 30 rupees and this will be 34 rupees. Now, variable cost per unit of jexting with internal transfer. When you buy internally at the rate of 50 per unit. So, 50 per unit into 2 units are required plus other variable cost. All are given in the question. I have just copied. So, it is 142 rupees. And variable cost per unit of jexting with outside purchase. If you buy from outside at the rate of 47, then it will be just this will be replaced by 47 into 2. Rest all the costs will be same, but it will become 136. This is just some key information, some data, which will help us to calculate the answer very fast. Now, division Y can sell only 120,000 units of Jexting, though the capacity was 150,000 units, if you remember, for division Y. I'm sure, I think you can keep the question in front of you. You have the capacity to produce 150,000 units, but you can sell only 120,000 units in the outside market. I am talking for division Y. Now, your profit is always restricted by what you can produce or what you can sell, whichever is lower. Now, for which it will require 120,000 into 2, that is 240,000 units of Jex as input. In division X, the total plant capacity is to produce 5 lakh units of Jex, out of which 240,000 is assumed to be used for internal supply to division Y, because division Y purchases entire full requirement from X only. And the remaining capacity of 260,000 units is used to satisfy the external demand. We had discussed this, and this data will be useful for calculation of present profit. Now, I have used this approach. You can use any approach to get the profit. Profit of division X. We want to calculate division wise profit as well as overall profit. So, I will calculate division wise profit and then we will take the total. Now, this is for division X, I am saying. X sells GEX product. Okay. Contribution from internal transfer. Internally, you will transfer 240,000 units at the rate of 50. But for internal transfer, the variable cost will be 30. So, 50 minus 30, 20 rupees contribution per unit into 240,000 units. If you have calculator with you and you want to cross check, you can do that. Then contribution from external sales. Externally, you can sell only 260,000 units. Same at 50 rupees, but for external sales, the variable cost will be 34 rupees. That 4 rupees selling and distribution will be extra. So, difference is contribution per unit into number of units. This is your total contribution. And you have to just deduct the total annual fixed cost. So, contribution minus fixed cost, this is the profit of division X. Similarly, for division Y, division Y sells Jexting. Right? Externally, it will sell 120,000 units externally at 180 rupees sales price. 142 is variable cost, which we calculated above. So, difference contribution into number of units. This is your total contribution minus annual fixed cost, and this is your profit. And if you take the total of these two profits, you will get the total profit earned by the company, 75,20,000 as a whole. Is that clear? And the data is written here only, right? You have all this relevant data here and in the question. So, this is your profit at present. Now, so what was the second question? Just check. Okay, I'll read the question from printed notes itself, or you can also read it from printed notes instead of going back. So, second question was, analyze the impact on the total annual profit of each division and the company as a whole if division Y accepts the offer of new supplier. That is this question we'll see. If you accept the offer of new supplier. See, for division Y, what will happen? Division Y's purchase price will go down. That is, variable cost will go down. We had calculated the revised variable cost here. if you buy from outside, this will be the variable cost. If you buy from outside at 147, so variable cost goes down, contribution will go up, contribution per unit will go up for division Y. But for division X, what will happen, do you know? As division Y is not buying from division X will be able to sell how many units? Production capacity or external demand, whichever is lower. And if you read the question again, the capacity of division X is 5 lakh units, but demand is only 3 lakh. So it will be able to sell only 3 lakh units in the external market, and 2 lakh unit capacity will remain unutilized. Why unutilized? Because division Y is not buying internally, division Y is buying from outside. So with this, we will see the statement. So profit of division X will be able to sell only in the external market, but now it can sell all 3 lakh units in the external market at 50 rupees, and 34 rupees was the variable cost for external sale. So this will be the total contribution minus fixed cost. There is no internal transfer, and this is the profit of division X. Now division Y will be able to sell 120,000 units in the external market at 180, but now the revised variable cost will be 136 because input price has gone down. So contribution has gone up minus fixed cost, and this is the profit. Actually division Y's profit has gone up. If you check the profit of division Y here, from 25,60,000 it has gone up to 32,80,000. But division X profit, if you check, 49,60,000 was earlier profit, it has gone down to 8 lakh. And the overall profit has also gone down of the company. Overall profit is 40,80,000. So there is a reduction in the overall profit of the company. So I have written the comment: as can be observed from the above two calculations, that the overall profit of the company has been reduced by 34,40,000 due to outside purchase. Hence, outside purchase of Jex is not advisable for the company. Now let us read third question. I had not read it. So I'll go back till the time you read it from your printed notes. Third question. Third question. In the change scenario, discuss why top management should intervene and advise a suitable transfer price for component X for resolving the transfer pricing conflict. Now, due to conflict, what is happening? Company's profit is going down. So you have to resolve this. Which promotes goal congruence? Goal congruence is you have to think of the company as a whole, not individual division. So goal congruence is maximization of total profit through efficient performance and of the concerned division. Anyway, so some sentences are of no use. So now in the change scenario, means in this scenario, how management will interfere and will help or advise the divisions to resolve the conflict in the light of goal congruence, that is maximization of total profit. Now we have already seen that in second situation, the profit is higher. That is here the profit is higher. In the first situation, the profit is higher. This one, 75,20,000. So company should stick to internal transfer instead of buying externally. Now just to prove that, what you can do is you can calculate the price, the minimum price at which division X can offer the product to division Y, and you can calculate the maximum possible what division Y can offer to pay to X. And if there is a gap between these two, means if it is acceptable, you can easily resolve the conflict. So just let us see it here. Intervention of top management. Top management must intervene and resolve the transfer pricing conflict to promote goal congruence, as the company will suffer a loss of 34,40,000. Now from how this loss is calculated, the difference between the two profit, 75,20,000 and 40,80,000 total profit, that difference is 34,40,000. The minimum transfer price for division X shall be, the minimum transfer price for division X, if you remember the formula, it is variable cost or marginal cost plus opportunity cost, that is contribution lost on external sales. Now your marginal cost or variable cost for internal transfer is only 30 rupees. Variable cost for internal transfer is 30 rupees. And you are earning 16 rupees. You can check the question if you want. You are earning 16 rupees from outside sale. So if you divert the external sale to internal transfer, you will lose the opportunity to earn 16 rupees. So you can charge that 16 rupees and recover it from division Y. So 30 plus 4, 16 is 46 rupees is your minimum transfer price. And the maximum price which division Y can pay is lower of the following two. We have discussed this in the regular batch, how to calculate that maximum price. One is net incremental revenue. Net incremental revenue means sales price of division Y, I am saying, and variable cost, all other variable cost other than internal transfer. So you will get the remaining difference for what you can maximum pay for internal transfer. So minus variable cost excluding internal transfer, other than internal transfer. So I am taking remaining variable cost 180 minus remaining variable cost excluding JECS. Excluding JECS. So you get it at 138 rupees you can pay for JECS, but this you can pay for 2 units of JECS. So 138 divided by 2, you can maximum pay 69. This is one calculation. And second is outside purchase price. Outside purchase price was 47. Whichever is lower, not higher. Lower of 69 or 47, that is 47. It means division X is ready to give you at 46. And division Y is saying that I can pay you maximum 47, which is lower of the two. So you can easily resolve the conflict. X is ready to give you at 46. Why is he, on the contrary, you can pay maximum 47. So in between this, you can decide the price and your conflict will get resolved. So there won't be any conflict. So the top management can easily fix a transfer price between 46 and 47 per unit. This will also ensure the full utilization of plant capacity of Division X. Division X can manufacture all 5 lakh units in this case and will improve the overall profitability of the company. So I think it was a simple question for 10 marks on transfer pricing, and earlier questions were also very simple. So question 4 overall was simple. Now let's move to question 5. It is question 5A. APZ Company Limited manufactures spare parts and can be called high volume based manufacturing environment. The company is using the system of total productive maintenance, TPM, for maintaining and improving the integrity of manufacturing process. There are several different automated manufacturing machines located in the plant through which manufacturing of spare parts are done and supplied to cater the demand in the market. A 12-hour shift is scheduled to produce a spare part in APZ company. I think there is a spelling error here. Is scheduled to produce. It should be E, not product. A 12-hour shift is scheduled to produce. Please correct it. To produce a spare part in APZ Company Limited as shown in the schedule below. The shift has 15 minutes break. The shift has 3 15 minutes break and 10 minute cleanup period. The shift is of 12-hour and this shift has 3 breaks of 15 minutes each. It means 45 minutes lost and a 10 minute cleanup period. So one cleaning period is there for 10 minutes. 10 minutes period is only one, not 3. But the break is 3 times. So 3 is 3 15 minutes breaks a 10 minute cleanup period. Now prepare production schedule for automated machine A10 is cycle 10 seconds. Now what do we mean by cycle 10 seconds? It means to produce one component, one spare part, the manufacturing time required is 10 seconds, that is manufacturing cycle time. In 10 seconds you can produce one component, that is the speed of production. Then spare parts manufactured by you are 3360. Out of these manufactured parts, scrap generated or scrap parts, defective parts are 75 and unplanned downtime is 36 minutes. Now please remember, this downtime was planned. Break, cleanup, it is already planned, and unplanned downtime is idle time, that is 36 minutes. Okay, and the question is required. Calculate OEE, overall equipment effectiveness, that is the measure to for TPM, that is total productive maintenance. To measure the efficiency of your total productive maintenance, we use OEE, overall equipment effectiveness, and comment on it. I think a simple question. If you remember, OEE can be calculated as multiplication of three things, that is availability into performance. Performance is nothing but efficiency into quality ratio. So availability ratio into performance ratio. Performance ratio is efficiency ratio and quality ratio. If you multiply the three, you get OEE percentage. And if 85% and above is a world class performance, right? And below 85% is okay, not a world class performance. So that is the question. I think we should first tackle this only. Second question seems to be theory. Okay, this is a theory part, that is part two. So let's target the first part. Just have the look at data again, because we'll have to calculate three ratios and multiply them to get the OE. Simple question if you remember the formula. Should I take you to the answer now? We'll have to calculate effectively for how much time the machine was available. What was the efficiency? Efficiency ratio is standard time divided by actual time. And the quality. In quality, 75 units are scrapped. So you don't have 100% quality. So your quality ratio will be less than 100%. I'll directly take you to the answer. It's here. Just a minute. Now this is a shift of 12 hours. We'll convert all the data in minutes. Everything in minutes. So 12 hours into 60 minutes is total available time. That is gross available time. 720. Okay. Less downtime or idle time. There are three breaks of 15 minutes each. So 45 minutes gone here. Cleanup break was only one. That is 10 minutes. And unplanned downtime, which we had not planned, but it has occurred. That is 36. This total 91 minutes are gone. And effective time available for you is 629. Similarly, standard time allowed for actual output. Now this is important. Standard time for actual output, which we use in efficiency variance calculation. You have actually produced 3360 units and each unit requires 10 seconds. 10 seconds is the cycle time. 3360 units into 10 seconds will become 33,600 seconds. These seconds I am dividing by 60 to convert it into minutes. Right? Seconds converted into minutes. So that is 560. Now let us go for the ratios. Calculation of OE. First, availability ratio, that is effective time available divided by gross time. Effective time is this 629 numerator out of total 720, that is denominator, into 100. So you get 87.36% is your availability ratio. For performance ratio, that is efficiency ratio, it will be standard time divided by actual time. So performance ratio, that is efficiency ratio, is standard time divided by actual time. See, this is the standard time, 560, standard time required for actual output. And this is your actual time, 629. So actual time you are taking more than standard. If the workers are taking more time, it means their efficiency is less than 100%. So your efficiency ratio is 89.03%. And quality ratio. Quality ratio means number of units accepted divided by total number of units produced. Number of units accepted are 75 less, because 75 units got scrapped. So 3360 minus 75, remaining units are good units, divided by 3360. So your quality ratio is 97.77%. So your OE ratio is, multiply all the three ratios now. So after multiplying all the three, you get 76.04. 76.04 is not bad, but it is not the world class performance. And then you can write the comment. Since OEE ratio of APZ Company Limited is lesser than 85%, that is world class performance level, less than that, company is advised to improve in its each ratio, that is availability ratio, performance ratio, and quality ratio. And it can be done by collecting information related to all downtimes and losses on machines, analyzing such information through graphs, charts, making improvement decision thereon, like autonomous maintenance, preventive maintenance, reduction in setup time, etc., and implementing the same. Anyway, this is a comment, theory, answer. Now what was the second question? Second part of the question is, we have done with this part. The management of company has decided to ensure that things are done right at the first time and that the defects and waste are eliminated from operations. Thus, they are planning to implement total quality management also. It means they want to implement TQM in addition to TPM. Now, summarize the connection between TQM and TPM. You'll find this note is written in our regular batch, right? Comparison or connection between TQM and TPM. So you have to just write a note for 4 marks. Oh my God. So even if you write 4 points, it will be enough. It must be written here. You can read it, I think. Or if you want, I will also read. Connection between TQM and TPM. The connection between TQM and TPM is summarized below. TQM and TPM make the company more competitive by reducing cost, improving customer satisfaction, and slashing the lead time. Lead time is the time gap. So wherever time is wasted, you can reduce that. Actually, both these TQM and TPM will complement each other. They will support each other for overall efficiency improvement. Involvement of the workers into all phases of TQM and TPM is necessary. Both processes need fundamental training and education of participants. And TPM and TQM take a long time to notice sustained tangible benefits, and commitment from top management is necessary for successful implementation. Now, these are the common points between the two, TQM and TPM. That was for 4 marks. Just few points you have to write, and you'll find such comments are written in our regular batch notes also. I take you to another question. Okay, another question is question B. 5B. SPS Limited uses activity-based costing to allocate variable manufacturing overheads, variable manufacturing overhead cost to products. The company identified 3 activities with the following information for last quarter. 3 activities are indirect material, product testing, and energy. Standard rate means SRR. You can say standard recovery rate, or in case of activity-based costing, it will be your activity cost driver rate. It is 20 per kilogram, 3 per test minute, 0.20 per minute of machine time. Standard quantity for units produced. Okay. Standard quantity per unit produced. Sorry. Per unit. This data is for each unit. So standard quantity required for one unit. 0.5 kg, 10 minutes per unit, 4 minutes of machine time per unit. This is actual cost and this is actual quantity. Okay. Just go through the data. Actual cost and actual quantity of input consumed. Input here is indirect material in kg. Here it is testing minutes, and here it is machine time. That is actual quantity of input. The company produced 80,000 units in the last quarter. This is actual output. This is actual output, and for to produce this actual output, this is the actual cost, and this is the actual quantity of input consumed to produce that output. Now, company's policy is to investigate all variances above 5% of the flexible budget amount for each activity. Now, this sentence is to be understood. Read it again. Company's policy is to investigate all variances above 5%. Of the flexible budget amount for each activity. Again, institute has used the word flexible budget. This flexible budget is nothing but standard cost of actual output. Standard cost of actual output. See, in standard costing, we always calculate for comparison standard cost of actual output, and then we compare it with actual cost. Now, what it means to produce 80,000 units of output, what should be the cost? What should be the cost is your flexible budget amount. And check the difference between that cost and actual cost. If the difference is more than 5%, above 5%, then your flexible budget cost means standard cost. If the variation is more than 5% in each activity, then you will investigate that activity. Are you getting it? It means management wants to ignore up to 5% difference or variation. If the variation is beyond 5% of standard, then they would do the further investigation. Just have a look at the data. Now, what is the question? Question is for total 10 marks, 6, 2 and 2. Out of which first question is, calculate variable overhead expenditure variance and efficiency variance for each of the activities using activity-based costing. So it's a mixture of your standard costing with activity-based costing, and clearly indicate each variance as favorable or unfavorable, that is adverse. So this is a practical question where you have to calculate the variances. Expenditure variance also you have to calculate. Efficiency variance also you have to calculate. In variable overheads, you have only 2 variances, and the total variance, basically expenditure plus efficiency is total cost variance. But they have asked you to calculate expenditure and efficiency for each activity, and there are 3 activities. So 3 into 2, there are 6 answers for 6 marks. Means 1 mark for each answer. Then interpretation of variances, I think they are asking. Interpret the result of variable overhead efficiency variance only. They are asking you to interpret the result of variable overhead efficiency variance as calculated in one above. And that too in respect of only indirect material and product testing activity. So for two activities, you have to interpret the efficiency variance, whatever it is, adverse or favorable. So you have to just give interpretation of two variances, two efficiency variances for indirect material and product testing, that is for 2 marks. And identify the variances that should be investigated according to the company's policy and show the calculation to support it. So third question is again practical. You have to show out of these three activities, right, these three activities, which activities have to be investigated. If the variation is more than 5%, then we will investigate that activity. So you have to just show that calculation and tell which activities to be investigated. Are you ready? Should we go to the answer? Answer will be simple. I can explain from here also if you want, but let us revise the formulas of standard costing first, expenditure and where it is going, yeah, expenditure and efficiency variance. Check this. This I have already discussed with you. This question is related to standard costing with activity-based costing. We have these type of questions in our version 3 notes, version 3 volume 2 notes on page 239 and 240, you will find that. On version 3 I am saying, for version 2 the page numbers will be different. You have to slightly modify the formula of variable overhead expenditure and efficiency variance and then use it here. What is the original formula of variable overhead expenditure variance? SRR per hour into actual hours minus actual hours. This is the original formula. SRR per hour into actual hours. Now here we will have to modify the formula in the light of activity based costing. And for variable overhead efficiency variance, the formula is multiplier SRR per hour into, in the bracket, standard hours, but standard hours required for actual output, minus actual hours. These are the two formulas. Just recollect these formulas, then I will take you back to the question. Expenditure variance is SRR per hour into actual hours minus actual hours. And efficiency will be SRR per hour as a multiplier into, in the bracket, standard hours minus actual hours. Now see how it will be calculated. Here the question is, check this. Expenditure variance, think over. Expenditure variance was SRR per hour into actual hours. Actual hours, not actual output. Actual hours. Now SRR here I will take 20 per kg of that material, and instead of actual material, actual hours, I will take this actual quantity of input, means 20 per kilogram into 48,000 kilogram, which you have actually consumed. How much should be the cost? And we'll compare this with this actual cost, 9,40,000, and you will get the expenditure variance. Are you getting it? Just logically substitute the data in the formula. Instead of SRR per hour, I will take that standard recovery rate, that is activity cost driver rate, into number of times that activity is carried out, minus actual cost. Now for efficiency variance, what we will do? I'll just make some space for efficiency variance. For efficiency variance, SRR per hour will be this only. Instead of per hour, it is per kg here, that is activity cost driver rate, but into, in the bracket, it was standard hours for actual output. So for that, what I'll do, I'll calculate standard quantity for actual output. Now see, the standard quantity for one unit is 0.5 kg and your actual output is 80,000. So for 80,000 units, the quantity consumed should be 80,000 into 0.5, that is 40,000 kg should be consumed. But actually you have consumed 48,000 kg. So you have consumed 8,000 kg more. That 8,000 kg into 20 rupees per kg. This will be efficiency variance. Are you getting it? So use the same logic, slightly modify the formula, and that is why the reason we have discussed standard costing using logic with slight modification. This is what you will do for everything else, like for product testing. If you want to calculate expenditure variance, the expenditure variance will be calculated as, this is SRR per minute here, right? 3 per test minute into 7,40,000 test minutes. This should be the expenditure minus this actual cost. You will get expenditure variance. And for efficiency variance, what you will do? For efficiency variance, we will take the same rate, 3 per minute, but into, In the bracket, we want standard hours minus actual hours. So instead of standard hours, I'll take standard minutes required for actual output minus actual minutes. Now for one unit, you need 10 minutes. So 10 minutes into 80,000, 8 lakh minutes should have been taken for production. And you have taken 7,40,000 minutes. So as compared to 8 lakhs, you have taken lesser time. So here the efficiency variance will be favorable. And so on. I hope you can easily do it now. Right? Answers are already printed. So I'll take you to third part now. Second part is interpretation theory part. And third part is whether we should investigate the variances or not. If the difference is more than 5%. So this is how I have calculated for indirect material. You will find expenditure variance, efficiency variance is calculated. For product testing, expenditure and efficiency. Now you can try on your own and then check with the answer. I've just given you the logic for energy, expenditure and efficiency variance. Then interpretation for two activities. Only efficiency variance has to be interpreted. Now check this. Actually, the total of these two variances will be your cost variance. This expenditure plus efficiency will be cost variance, right? Like this is 20,000 favorable, this is 1,60,000 adverse. So net will be 1,40,000 adverse. Again, these two, you will get total cost variance. So we'll have to see the total variation from standard. If it is more than 5%, then we'll have to do the investigation. Now I have prepared one table for investigation of variances. Name of three activities are given. Let us go one by one, one activity. I'm calculating standard cost per unit of output now. Standard cost per unit of output. For example, for indirect material, you need the rate is given to you as 20 per kg and you need 0.5 kg to produce one unit of output. So standard quantity into standard price. So 10 rupees is the standard cost for one unit of output into actual output 80,000. So the total cost, standard cost should be 8 lakh. This 8 lakh cost, that is standard cost of actual output, is called as flexible budget. Actual cost is 9,40,000 given to you in the question. This difference is your total cost variance. This is the difference, 1,40,000 adverse. This difference you can cross check from expenditure plus efficiency together. Now allowable difference is only 5%. 5% of what? 5% of standard. So 8 lakh into 5%. Allowable difference is 40,000. 40,000 is allowable difference, but the actual difference is 1,40,000. That is more. So if it is more than 5%, you should investigate. Are you getting it? Similarly, for all the three you can do. Actually, all three answers are coming investigate, because in all three, your variation is more than 5%. Remaining you can go through because answers are printed. So I will not waste much of your time. We'll go to the next question now. 6A. Question 6A. We have completed 5B. Okay. 6A is SEZ Limited produces three products, S, Q and L, which use the same resources but in varying quantities. Product S uses one unit of component P, which is purchased from outside at 120 per unit, and you use only one unit of P. Details of three products are as follows. Please remember, S, Q and L are your products, means output which you manufacture and sell. And P is one of the component which you use to manufacture S. Here you use. Now annual demand is given for all the three. Data is given per unit, means one unit of output. Selling price is given. Component P's cost is given, which you buy at 120 for only S, not for Q and L. Direct material, 8 per kg is the rate of raw material, and 24 rupees, 32 rupees and 24 rupees is the cost of that material, right? If you want to calculate quantity of material used, then 24 divided by 8 kg, you will get quantity, that is 3 kg you will get. So 3 kg of material used at the rate of 8 per kg, 8 per kg into 3, you will get 24 rupees, and so on. Skilled labor is at the rate of 40 per hour. Unskilled labor is at the rate of 24 per hour, and variable overheads are 6 per machine hour, not labor hour, 6 per machine hour. So all this is charge, all this is variable cost actually. And annual fixed costs are 15 lakhs given below. Now maximum availability of skilled labor is 16,200 hours. Okay, maximum availability of skilled labor. So this skilled labor is available only 16,200 hours. So that's a key factor concept here. and other resources are sufficient to meet the annual demand / sales. It means there is no restriction on other resources. There is only one restriction on skill deliver. So skill deliver is the only key factor here. Now, engineering division of the company came forward with a proposal to make component P. Engineering division is saying that we will make component P in house. So at present you are buying the component from outside. You are buying component P at 120 rupees from outside. Okay, here. So they want to make it on their own. And the following is the cost breakup. Now this cost breakup is to manufacture one of the component P. Your direct material at 8 per kg is 24 rupees. Skilled labor, unskilled labor and variable overheads at 6 per machine hour and total cost. This is variable cost. So you can manufacture it at 90 rupees. Whereas your outside purchase price is 120. So your naturally your manufacturing cost is lower than purchase price. So prima facie you will notice that it is cheaper to manufacture. That is correct. Now for in-house making of component P, there will not be any change in the annual fixed cost of the company. So annual fixed cost will remain same. Simply speaking, there is no additional fixed cost for making component P. So there is no incremental fixed cost. And therefore, in this entire question, fixed cost will be relevant because it will remain unchanged. Now, the company can either buy component P or make it in-house. So this question seems to be of make or buy decision, right? Make or buy. You can make the component P or you can buy it from outside. Okay, it's a simple question. It seems required, recommend optimum production plan and profit for the year and show calculation in support of your answer. Okay, recommend the optimum production plan, best production plan using that key factor. So my dear friend, it's a question of make or buy plus key factor. We have solved many such questions in the classroom. So make or buy with key factor. I'll wait for some time, just go through the question. Just form your opinion, then I will discuss and then we'll go to the solution. Just try to form your opinion. See friends, the approach will be, as skilled labor is a key factor, for three products, S, Q and L, we will calculate contribution per key factor. Contribution per key factor, that is contribution per skilled labor, we will calculate. Then what we'll do? We'll compare this cost of component P. This is purchase cost 120 and manufacturing cost is 90. So you can save how much? 30 rupees. But to save 30 rupees, how much skilled labor you have to use? See, skilled labor at the rate of 40 per hour is rupees 40. Means you are using only 1 hour. So in 1 hour, you can save 30 rupees. Is that okay? In 1 hour, you can save 30 rupees. Now, that is saving on P is 30. And on manufacture of SQL, how much contribution you earn per hour of skilled labor? That we have to check. And from there, we'll decide the ranking. And based on that ranking, we can use our limited hours of 16,200. These hours we can use based on the ranking. And then that ranking will tell you that which product or whether component P should be manufactured within available time. And that is what the question is. And then as per the decision, we will calculate the profit. So you have to recommend that production plan. That is how you will utilize those 16,200 hours to manufacture product SQL and to manufacture component P on the basis of priority. Okay. And once that decision is taken, calculation of profit will be easy. So according to me, it's an easy question, make or buy plus key factor. So I'll take you to the answer here. See, it's a statement of contribution per hour and ranking. For these three, you will get contribution per unit because these products are selling. And for component P, you will get saving per hour. So I'm not taking you in detail. You can do it on your own. It's always advisable to first try the question on your own on rough paper and then check with the solution. That will help you more. If you are just reading question and reading answer like I'm doing, because I have to just explain, I've already solved it for you. But if you are also reading question and reading answer, the benefit will not be 100%. The benefit will be 25%. But if you read the question carefully, you solve it independently on rough paper at least, and then check it with my printed solution, I think the benefit to you will be more. See, finally, you have to solve the question in the exam hall and not me. So do it on your own and then check. I'm just discussing this. Contribution / saving, contribution for these three. This is per unit contribution, please remember. And this is saving. And then it should be divided by hours required per unit. And how you'll calculate hours per unit? This skilled labor cost divided by 40 rupees per hour. And you will get the contribution / saving, and you will get the ranking. I think rank 1 goes to product S, rank 2 goes to L, rank 3 goes to Q, and this saving of 30 rupees per hour is the last rank. It means P will get the last rank to be produced. It means if time left, then, and then this is the optimum production plan in 16,200 hours. We first manufactured S, first rank, then we manufactured second rank L. And I think time is short, so Q you have manufactured only in remaining time, and there is no time left for component P, so P will not be manufactured. So in the above calculation, it may be noticed that we are not left with any time to produce component P, hence entire requirement of P has to be purchased from outside. Though from outside purchase, you are paying 30 rupees extra, but if that time is used for other products, you can earn more than 30 rupees per hour. Are you getting it? So it is advisable to first manufacture, and then based on this production plan, you can calculate the profit also. So on these three productions, sales price minus variable cost, you will get contribution per unit. So you will get this contribution, simple, total contribution minus fixed cost. You are not manufacturing, you are buying from outside, and that buying cost we have already considered in calculation of cost of S. Please remember, this buying cost of S, we have buying cost of P, we have already considered in calculation of S, and we are going to buy only, not manufacture. So minus fixed cost, and we'll get the profit. So I think the question was simple. Check the 6B question. What is 6B? Okay, the 6B is a case scenario. So it's a theory question. You can read the solution. This is case scenario. On feedback control and feed forward control for 10 marks. So I'm leaving this to you. You can read this theory question on your own and check the solution also of this 6B, right, on your own. And with this, we have completed this suggested answer also. So next is the RTP. There are two RTPs ahead, but I will take up the RTP in the next lecture. So I'll stop it here for the day, my dear friends. Right, in the next lecture, we'll start from here. So in next lecture will be lecture number 5. We'll start from RTP of November 2019. Okay, friends, we'll stop here for the day. Bye-bye.